Sona Mohapatra is a performer who's changed the game as much with her full-throated voice as with her fierce opinions. The documentary Shut Up Sona covers her unrelenting fight for equal representation of women in the music industry, with a much larger goal of creating equal space for women in India. So Sona, what made you want to produce a film on yourself?
Well, it's not so much. I think I'm just the medium in the film. It's a universal story. Told from the eyes of a female artist. And there's a lot of music and love for the roots of where we are, and a lot of travel, a lot of my interest in the music outside of just the idea of, you know, seeking equal rights. And yes, and the way my life went, because it was not something that was planned for, there was so much of conflict and so many things that came up during the shooting of the film, that, yeah, it became the heart of the film and a very important part of it too. So what made me want to produce this film? Well, I don't think anybody else would have to start with on a lighter note. But just to tell you, 3 years ago, I found myself in a corner. I felt the opportunities for female artists were getting smaller and smaller. Over the years, out of 100 odd songs that would release in the mainstream, not even 7 to 8 would have a female voice in a dominant would have enough lines even in a romantic duet. Somehow, things are not just stacked up to help women create big artist brands in India. NH7 doesn't have you as a headliner. Women don't even show up in the Mood Indigos and the IITs, and, you know, where you think the progressive liberal thought should be residing. You know, one is for me to sit around and complain about it, but I'm not one of them. It's time to take charge of my own narrative, mm-hmm. and charge of my own destiny, so to say. And yeah, marry all my love for travel, for storytelling, for music, and expression. So 300 hours of footage, 3 years of shoot, and Shut Up Sona came to being. And the best part was, just 10 days after the film got made, we managed to premiere it in Mami, which was an official selection, the spotlight section. And the screenings there made me realize that maybe I'm some kind of a stand-up act or something, because that was not the plan, but people were laughing through the film. Of course, there were a lot of tears and emotions, which was quite overwhelming, the response to the film. And then we got officially selected for some of the top 5 festivals of the world, Rotterdam, Gothenburg, and we're headed to a few more now. So I realized that the story found a universal resonance across cultures. And yeah, I think gender issues are at a flashpoint right now. Women are in the forefront of everything. And I, of course, am a fighter in the, you know, whole Me Too movement. And I don't think it's getting over anytime soon. And I found an incredible sisterhood. And I think I feel fortunate that I also have some really good men in my life. Apart from my own partner, my whole band is full of young men who give me not hope. I mean, I'm very, very confident about the fact that things are getting better and really fast, because they are very comfortable with the opposite gender. They don't seem to be dying to be putting the women in their life down. In fact, they're trying to make up for whatever stories they might have heard from their mothers about how unfair things were for her. They give me a lot of love. You know, not my band and just my partner. The country gives me a lot of love. I perform to lakhs in my shows who show up, and not just in the fancy metros. You know, I'm talking about the tier 2 towns. And, you know, I just did Jhansi, Aligarh, Vishakhapatnam, Rewa. These are the places I also get to perform to. And I realize India is rapidly changing. And yeah, I think Shut Up Sona will be part of that narrative of India, which is seeking change.
So how involved were you in the creative process of the documentary as a producer?
You know, I am the protagonist. So I was in the... obviously, it's not a scripting or one of those kind of films. It grew very organically. I never interfered in the edit. Music is something, of course, I played a big role in. A lot of it is my own music. Creatively, yeah, I am in the film and it's my music, so I was pretty much there creatively. But in terms of shaping the narrative, I believed I played a role in saying that, yeah, my life seems to be full of conflict, so let's flaunt it. Let's not just hide and say that let's just talk about music or performances, or let's not make it one of those documentaries which most people, it blows up your own sense of, you know, self-importance when you have this, you know, just big fancy concerts, 2 lakh people are coming, drone shots. But yeah, in terms of doing the hard haul, I worked my butt off to make sure that every time I would literally go and work, make enough money for it. It was a tough film to make because it was very ambitious in its scale. Normally, documentaries end up being shot in a mohalla, if not one city. We went to more than 18 cities. It was truly that love letter to India that I wanted to write. And I started off by saying it's a love letter to a country which is uncomfortable with my emancipation or empowerment. But it's a love letter nevertheless, because we found such generous people along the way. I just felt a renewed love for my land, you know, with the whole process of the last 3 years. And the fact that I think, you know, right now there's a lot of turmoil in around, and a lot of things are at a flashpoint. The Me Too movement came in between. I was at that point of time, even while we were shooting, one of the first judges on the Saregamapa, first female judges in 23 years on the Saregamapa main show. And when I called out Anu Malik and Kailash Kher, which came across the headlines at that point, the first one to be punished, Anu Malik was not asked to leave Indian Idol immediately. I was asked to leave Saregamapa, you know, within 24 hours. So there are consequences of being as vocal and as maybe crazy as I am, but I have no regrets. Seems to be working out. Yeah.
So you just mentioned that there has been a price to pay. What keeps you going? Has there been a change, you know, in the scenario?
I feel when you end up losing some work because of what you stand for and what you believe in, it's the kind of work you anyway never meant to do. And the work that comes your way, or the allies, the friends that come your way, are the ones which you take you much further, and you end up doing the kind of work that makes you really proud. So in the long run, I've never really seen any huge downside of being myself. You know, I think only grown from strength to strength as an artist. I play to bigger and bigger crowds, and I've found my allies, you know, and they might be few, but they're the ones worth working with. So yeah, what keeps me going? The fact that I'm on the right side of history.
So you have, you know, called out various people in the past for being sexist towards women performers or women in general. Have you noticed a change over time since then?
There's a lot of change happening right now. People think before they behave a certain way in the workplaces. And I'm talking specifically after this whole Me Too movement happened. I think conversations in the public domain, which come about when you do a call out or you start a conversation or a debate, they help people think and reevaluate their attitudes about certain things. Mm-hmm. And that does bring about change. It may not be overnight, but I see a very visible change, you know, in front of my own eyes, even in terms of in the industry that I'm in. I mean, people will rethink. Another Vikas Vel is not going to come in a hurry. A Sajid Khan is not going to be entertained in the industry. I mean, people realize that that is a terrible human being, and that kind of person should not be entertained, and women should not be made to feel unsafe and need to do favors to go along, you know. So I think the change is happening and pretty visible.
So you've been a crusader for the Me Too movement, but do you feel that sometimes people that you've stood up for have not stood up for themselves? I'm talking about Suman Sridhar, who you said that, you know, Anu Malik was harassed her and misbehaved with her. But then she went on to deny the claims, and she said that there's no truth to this. It's completely fabricated.
You know, it's very sad that Suman had to do that. But she must have her own compulsions, or maybe in a vulnerable place. And I did, you know, receive some very strange messages from her. And I realized it's not for me to try and change her, or try and figure out what exactly. Because, you know, I had nothing to gain to share with the fact that she was a young upcoming singer who used to keep coming to me with these worries. And not just me, she came to even Ram. So it was not something I was cooking up. But it's her choice to have not acknowledged it, you know, for whatever it was worth. I felt let down at that point of time, but I've grown to think that maybe I shouldn't have brought up Suman's. You know, at that point of time, we were collectively as women trying to find enough strength to make the story, because everybody would be questioning the victims. And it's almost like 10 women are not enough, 12 are not enough, 14 are not enough. How many women and their story should be enough for you to believe that this is, You know, at that point of time when I was being asked, but you were just said this and yay, this is not, doesn't warrant any. I was, yeah, but I also know of 20 other things that I was engaged with at that point of time to know that this guy was a really perverted guy, you know, and to build strength, you share, you know, statistics. And then I feel maybe I shouldn't have. And anyway, after I called him out, 12 more women came out with their stories and there were some minors in the mix. And yet, Sony TV took him back on Indian Idol next year. So despite that, and what I gathered, which was the most shocking part of it all, that this year, Sony as a channel used sexual harassment as a theme for their marketing campaign on the show. You know, very few people connected the dots that they not only hired Anu Malik, knowing very well that multiple women have called him out on sexual harassment. They also staged a video where a contestant is, molesting one of their judges, Neha Kakkar. And they made it viral. They paid to make it viral. They put it on the covers of each of their official pages. And you would think, I've been a judge on a show. There is no way a contestant comes 2 feet away from you. They're constantly like just desperate to win. A contestant actually mauled you, kissed you forcibly. You made that into a video that went viral. And it was very apparent to me that, oh, wow, this is a great marketing ploy. You get Anu Malik and these women are going to go crazy and protest and that will be publicity. And now you'll make such a video viral. So you're using sexual harassment of women as a theme for your marketing campaign. How diabolical or disgusting is that?
And what is the, you know, one thing that you'd want the audience to take away from this?
Well, tell your own story and find your own opportunities and sing your own song and be yourself. And I feel be very proud of your roots and your identity. You know, the fact that I flaunt my Indian cultural roots, and that's the way to feel patriotic, not about, you know, there's a lot of crazy happening right now where everybody thinks that they are more patriotic than the other. The other is, which is why I felt, you know, you walk your talk. You make your own story happen and you express yourself, you know, in the most honest way you can. And as an artist, I've never seen myself just as a singer. You know, I've always known myself to go hopefully beyond that and create some kind of a legacy which I'm proud of. And this is just not my story. It is a universal call out for a sisterhood, call out for an equal voice for all women who are seeking a strong voice and a place in their workplaces. So, and it just told through me. So it's not really, it's not some kind of an autobiographical film, honestly. And which is why, you know, there were, I think only in India, I had people and some friends also strangely on Twitter, they took, oh, you found yourself so important, you made a film on yourself. I said, yeah, you would have no issue when a hagiography was made around Sanjay Dutt. That would be fine by you. But you know what? You must watch the film before you judge it. Because yes, I did make a film which has me as the central character, but it's hoping to tell a story that goes beyond me. It's not just about me.
Right. Thank you for being so candid, Sona. It's been lovely talking to you.
Pleasure.